aspirants, welcome to the Hindu News Analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the day 25th of September 2021. So displayed below are the list of news articles that we have chosen for today's discussion, and they are also given along with the page numbers of different editions. Further, the link in the handwritten notes in PDF format and also the time stamping for the discussed articles is given in the comment section as well as in the description box. Now let us take up this article, and this article is about a new scheme which is recently notified by the Union Government, and this recently notified scheme is titled as the Scheme for the Promotion of Medical Device Park. So for this scheme, a financial outlay of rupees 400 crore has been allotted, and this amount has been allotted till the financial year 2024-25. So with this idea in mind, let us now look at the various aspects of the said scheme, which will be helpful for a preliminary examination. So with this idea in mind, now let us look at the various aspects of this said scheme, which will be important for us in our exam perspective. See, whenever you come across a new scheme in the newspaper, you should always make it a point to look into the following aspects of the scheme, say like that of whether the scheme comes under which ministry and department, and you should also know who is the implementing authority of that scheme, and you should know the objectives of the scheme, and also you should make it a point to find out the funding aspects of the scheme. So when I say funding, I don't mean the actual fund that is being allocated, but rather you should note on how the funding is being shared between the center and the states. So to put it in simple words, you should know whether it is a central sector scheme or a centrally sponsored scheme. And then finally, you should also note where this particular scheme is being implemented, like if it is implemented for the entire India or if only a few states are exclusively chosen for it. Okay, so whenever you come across any scheme in the newspaper, you always make it a point to focus on these areas, because when you look back at the previous year's question paper, you find that whenever any scheme is mentioned in the question paper, mostly these areas are covered there. So when you cover these aspects, you can certainly answer any question regarding the scheme in preliminary stage. Okay, so these aspects are important for your preliminary examination. But then when it comes to the mains examination, you have to cover the significance of a particular scheme. You should also know to analyze the scheme and to bring out the critical aspects of the scheme. But since this particular scheme is a newly launched scheme, let us wait for some more time to get into the critical part of the scheme. So as of now, with the details available, we are going to mainly focus on the preliminary aspects. So the first point about this scheme is that this particular scheme comes under the Department of Pharmaceuticals. And this Department of Pharmaceuticals, it comes under the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. So the first point is this scheme comes under the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. Now coming to the second point, have in mind this particular scheme is implemented by the state implementing agency, which means a separate organization is responsible for the implementation of the scheme in different states. Now say for example, when you take the schemes on skill development in electronic systems design and manufacturing sector, it was a scheme that was notified by the Union Government. But still, this scheme is implemented in Tamil Nadu by the Tamil Nadu Skill Development Corporations. So I hope you guys understand what implemented by the state implementing agency means now. Now coming to the third point, which is the objectives of the scheme. See, basically this scheme has got two major objectives. So the first objective is that the scheme aims to create world-class common infrastructure and also testing facilities, and this is done to ensure easy access. And in addition to this, the main aim here is to reduce the cost of production of medical services. Now this is because when the cost of production is reduced, the industry will be more competitive in the world market. And when it becomes more competitive in the world market, we as Indians can also get affordable medical devices in the domestic market. So this is the first objective. Now coming to the second objective. See, through this particular scheme, the government is actually aiming to achieve economy of scale. So let me explain this concept of economy of scale. See, basically this economy of scale is a microeconomic concept, and this concept refers to the savings in cost business entity experiences by making the production process more efficient. See, the economy of scale can be achieved by two ways. One is internally, and the next way is externally. So through this particular scheme, the government is actually aiming to achieve the economy of scale externally. That is, since all the industry will be located close to each other, it will be more feasible to share the skilled labor and common infrastructure. So thereby to bring down more feasible to share the skilled labor and common infrastructure. So when they have the potential to share skilled labor and common infrastructure, there are high chances for them to bring down the overall cost of production. So this is also an objective of this scheme. So by now we have a kind of understanding about the scheme's objectives. Now let's move on to the next aspects of the scheme, which is the funding aspect. See, as of now, the government has given a financial outlay of rupees 400 crore for the period financial year 2020 to 2021 to the financial year 2024 to 2025. So this allocated financial assistance would be provided by the center. So under this, the center will provide up to 70% of the total cost of creating the common infrastructure for the states. Whereas in the case of northeastern and NLE states, the center will provide an assistance of up to 90% of the total cost of creating the common infrastructure. So this sharing between the center and the state with regards to the funding will be an important focus area when it comes to the preliminary exam. So make sure you have in mind whether it is a central sector scheme or a centrally sponsored scheme, and you should also make it a point to note down the amount of financial assistance that is being given by the central government. So coming to the final aspect, that is where the scheme is being implemented. See, the Union government has given a principal approval for the scheme to be implemented in four states. And these four states that are chosen are the states of Tamil Nadu, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Himachal Pradesh. See, these four states were not selected randomly. So what happened actually is that the Union government, they received proposals from around 16 states, and from the proposal that was given by the states, the Union government, they self-evaluated all the states based on various parameters, say like that of utility charges, the land lease rate, the ease of doing business ranking, the availability of technical manpower, etc. So based on all these parameters, the Union government judged the 16 states from where the proposal came, and based on its judgment, the Union government has selected four states, and those four states are the states of Tamil Nadu, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Himachal Pradesh. So you can actually use this point in your mains examinations whenever you get a question regarding the competitive federalism. So by now we have actually covered all the five major aspects of the scheme, which I told you earlier. That is those areas which were frequent in the preliminary examination. So now let us see a little bit about the significance of the scheme, which you can use in your mains preparation. So first of all, we must understand why this particular sector has been chosen when there is a lot of sectors available. See, the fact here is that the medical device manufacturing industry is actually a sunrise industry. So when I say a sunrise industry, it means an industry that is relatively new and that which will be growing at a fast pace, and also an industry which has got the potential to gain a lot of importance in the coming days. So that is the reason why this particular sector has been chosen. Now, apart from manufacturing sector, some other sunrise sector includes the hydrogen fuel production sector, the electric vehicle sector, the edutech companies, space tourism, etc. So therefore, since this medical device manufacturing is a sunrise industry, the government is focusing on it. Now the next significance is the government's push towards Atmanirbhar, that is a self-sufficient India in the medical device production. And the government, by choosing this particular sector, is attempting to try and make it complement the already well-developed pharmaceutical sector in India. So therefore, on that line, once the scheme is fully implemented and when India becomes self-sufficient in medical device production, then our country will become the world leader in those areas relating to the medical sector, right from pharmaceutical to medical device production. So this is also an important aspect of this scheme and also an important reason why government is focusing more on this particular sunrise industry. So with this, we have come to the end of this discussion. So to have a quick recap, in this discussion, we saw the five important aspects relating to the scheme for the promotion of medical device park, which will be important for the prelims. And we ended the discussion with some significance of the scheme, which will be useful for us in our mains preparation. So by now, I hope you guys have understood and I try to cover all the major aspects of the scheme. And I also hope you guys don't require further research regarding this scheme. So with these learned points in mind, now let us move on to the next news discussion. Now look at this news article. So the news article mentions about an incident where an elephant was separated from its herd due to the flooding in Mahanadi River. So in order to rescue that separated elephant, the Odisha Disaster Rapid Action Force was sent. But then unfortunately, their boat overturned in the water and because of that, one person among them died. So this is the news here. Now let us keep this news aside. Instead, based on this context, let us discuss about Mahanadi River, which is in the limelight here. See, whenever you read about or you come across any river in the newspaper, please make sure to note for some important areas of that river. See, whenever you come across a river in the newspaper, you always try to focus on areas like whether it is an east or west flowing river, and you try to make a note of the states which is sharing the river's drainage basin, the notable tributaries of the river, and also the important projects or the dams that is being built in that river. And apart from this, also note if any environmentally important place is situated somewhere near to the river. So this is the basics of how you need to approach a river whenever you are learning. So even in this discussion, we are going to approach the Mahanadi River in the similar perspective only. See, Mahanadi is one of the major rivers of peninsular India. Now, according to NCRT, this particular Mahanadi River is said to rise in the highlands near Sihawa in the Raipur district of Chhattisgarh. And this particular river, it flows through Odisha to reach the Bay of Bengal, and there it forms a delta before entering itself into the Bay of Bengal. So therefore, it means that this is an east flowing river, or it flows eastwards and the river drains into the Bay of Bengal. Now next comes the length of the river. See, the river's length is about 860 kilometers and its drainage basin is shared by 5 states, and these 5 states are Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand and Odisha. Have in mind, the 5 states sharing the drainage basin of Mahanadi River are Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand and Odisha. So basically, this river is bounded by the central India hills in the north, and when you look at its south and east, it is bounded by the Eastern Ghats, and in the west, it is bounded by the Maikal hill range. Now, the next important points is the tributaries of the river. See, have in mind, the main left bank tributaries of Mahanadi are Sionath, Hasdeo, Mund and Hib. And when you take the right bank tributaries, they are the Ong, Tell and Jong. Now, among these tributaries, the tributary of Sionath, Ib and Tell, they alone together constitute nearly 46.63% of the total catchment area of the river, which is very less than half of the total catchment area of the river. And also make a note, the tributary Sionath is the longest tributary of the Mahanadi River. Now, another important thing which you should have in mind is that, see, here you should note that in respect to the water potential, this Mahanadi River ranks second to the Godavari River among the peninsular rivers. And another fact to be noted here is that the famous Chilika Lake of Odisha lies to the south of Mahanadi Delta. See, if you have carefully followed the news, you might have known that this particular river is often in news every year due to the inundation. So therefore, for the purpose of flood control along with irrigation and power generation, the Hirakud Dam project was built in this river. And this particular Hirakud Dam project was built across Mahanadi at about 15 kilometer upstream of Sambalpur town in Odisha. So this is one of the oldest hydel projects of India, and not just that, it is also the first post-independence major multi-purpose river valley project in the entire country. So whenever you learn about Mahanadi River, make it a point to refresh about the Hirakud Dam project. Now, apart from this, other important projects in the river are the Mahanadi Reservoir Complex. And this complex comprises of three dams, which includes the Ravi Shankar Sagar, the Dudhwaha and the Murumsili Dam. And apart from this, the Minimata Hasdeo Bango Irrigation Project of Chhattisgarh State is also a notable project here. And this particular project is situated in the Hasdeo River. And the third comes the Tandula Major Irrigation Project of Chhattisgarh, which is located in the Tandula River. And then comes the Jonk Diversion Project of Chhattisgarh. So these are some important projects that you should have in mind whenever you learn about the Mahanadi River. So with these prelims related facts in our memory, let us get on to the next discussion. Now our next news discussion is going to be based on this editorial article. Now look at this editorial. This editorial basically deals with the recent economic development of our country. So with this idea, let us approach this editorial article. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. See, according to the recent statistics, our country's unemployment rate has increased from 7% to 8.3%. That is, the unemployment rate in India was 7% in July 2021, and now this 7% has increased to 8.3% in the month of August 2021. So within the month itself, there was around 1.3% increase in the country's unemployment rate. So in absolute terms, our employment has shrunk from 399.7 million in July to 397.8 million in August. So that means we have actually lost around 1.9 million employment in just 1 month. So such is the intensity of the situation at present. And also it is important for us to know that we have lost most of these jobs in the farm sector. See, whenever there is a loss in farm jobs, the non-farm jobs usually absorb them. So with the recent loss in farm job, what happened is that there has been an increase in the employment in the non-farm jobs. But here the problem is that the quality of the new jobs generated in the non-farm jobs is a matter of concern. See, most of the lost farm jobs were absorbed by the low-end service activities. See, what happens is during normal times, people who have lost jobs from the agricultural sector, they tend to get accommodated in the construction sector. But currently, with the COVID pandemic on board, the construction sector is facing a struggle. And due to this, it is not able to employ any new persons. So because of this, many people are finding employment in the household sector and low-end services. See, when you carefully notice, this pattern is actually dangerous for our country. Now this is because the non-availability of jobs in manufacturing and high-end services could actually affect our economic recovery in the coming years. So this is the first important issue that is highlighted by the author in this editorial. Now moving on to the next important point. See, according to many economic experts, increasing investments is the key to economic development and also the key to employment growth. So this is why public investments play a very important role when it comes to the development of our country. But then in recent times, public investments is also struggling to produce the desired results. And one major reason for this is because the demand for products and services in our country has reduced due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So because of that, in addition to the public investments, we in fact need more private investments to achieve our result. But the problem here is even the private investments have been very low in recent times. So this on the whole is affecting our unemployment situation. Also remember, India heavily relies on foreign direct investment when it comes to the generation of jobs. Yes, foreign direct investment does generate jobs both directly as well as indirectly through an increase in the production activities. But at present, we are not sure about the magnitude of employment that is generated to this foreign direct investment. And not just that, even we are not sure about the sustainability of jobs which are generated through this foreign direct investment. So one major reason for this is because the jobs which are generated through the foreign direct investment is threatened by the corporate restructuring at the global level. So say for example, if a firm decides to exit from a location, we lose our jobs, like what is happening with the Ford issue. So this is not a sustainable one for a longer run. So after discussing about the FDI job generation, the author in the editorial gives special focus to the manufacturing sector. See, in recent times, the manufacturing sector has failed to create more jobs. And one major reason for this is because important sectors like that of automobiles has been failing to create new jobs. See, when you take the automobile sector, it employs around 19.1 million workers, both directly as well as indirectly. And not just that, it has also been an important driver of the manufacturing sector's output and employment growth. But in recent times, this automobile sector is facing a lot of roadblocks, and the author here has mentioned three major roadblocks that is faced by this automobile sector. So the first of them is the novel coronavirus pandemic and lockdowns. See, because of the pandemic, the aggregate demand in the economy is low, and this has affected the vehicle sales. Now secondly comes the shortage of semiconductors. See, the shortage of this semiconductors is impacting our production of vehicles. So this has also contributed to the decline in the automobile sector. Now thirdly comes the recent exit of Ford from the Indian market, because this exit will completely destroy many jobs and it will also create more unemployment. So these are basically the most prominent and the prevailing roadblocks that has affected the automobile sector severely. See, here you should always have in mind, the exits of the high profile global firms from Indian market is actually disastrous to our country. This is because such high profile exits affect our employment generation, and it also affects our private investments. And not just that, it slows our employment growth, and in addition to all these, it leads to one of the most difficult to combat issue, that is the issue of the unemployment. See, if a high-profile global firm exits from India, then there is a sudden release of high-skilled workers into the market. So this creates mismatches in the labor market, and this in turn aggravates our existing unemployment problem. So we can observe that the over-reliance on foreign direct investments to create jobs can be detrimental in the longer run, because with rising protectionism and unpredictability of policy environments, the trust in these high-profile global firms has begun to decline, because they are no longer seen as permanent institution, and there are high chances for them to exit from the Indian market at any point of time depending on their own needs and circumstances. So based on all these analysis, the author feels that in the longer run, we should concentrate more on domestic capital formation instead of relying on the foreign direct investments, because only this can offset the unpredictability. So these are the important points that this article wants to tell us. And now let's move on to the next news discussion. Now look at this news article. So this article basically reports about a recent speech that was given by our Lok Sabha speaker, and he gave this speech in the recently held joint session of the Karnataka State Legislature. So when you look into the context of the speech, during the speech, the speaker actually mentioned that the protests which are generally held during the parliamentary session should be done in accordance with the dignity of the house and also the parliamentary norms. Because in situations where it breaches the dignity of the house and the parliamentary norms, there are high chances for it to curtail the debates on important bills, which in turn will prevent the executive from fulfilling its duty. So this is the crux of the news article here. So now in this discussion with our prelims nearing, we will try and revise the various aspects of the office of the Lok Sabha speaker. See, the office of a speaker is an important position in the parliamentary democracy. So when you look at the order of precedence, the Lok Sabha speaker is actually placed in the sixth position. So being in the sixth position, the Lok Sabha speaker is sharing the position with the Chief Justice of India. So now let's see some important facts regarding the office of the speaker. See, firstly, the office of the speaker is a constitutional post, and the salaries and allowances of the speaker are generally charged in the consolidated fund and are not voted upon by the parliament. Now, secondly, the office of the speaker is guided by the constitutional provisions and the rules of procedure and conduct of business in Lok Sabha. And also have in mind, the adequate powers are vested in the office of the speaker in order to help him or her in the smooth conduct of parliamentary proceedings. And additionally, the speaker is assisted by the Secretary General of the Lok Sabha and the senior officers of the Secretariat on Parliamentary Activities, Practice and Procedure. Now coming to the appointment of the speaker. See, electing the speaker of the house is one of the first acts that is performed by the newly constituted house. Have in mind, the speaker is generally elected by a simple majority of the members present and voting in the Lok Sabha. Now here you should note the point present and voting. See, another important point regarding the election of the Lok Sabha speaker is that the constitution does not mention any special qualifications as such for a person to be appointed as a speaker. So that means the constitution just states that the speaker must be a member of the house, and through convention, people who have a good understanding of the constitution and conventions of the parliament is often selected as a speaker. Now here you should remember this, it is just a convention and it is nowhere mentioned in the constitution. So finally, a member belonging to the ruling party is elected as a speaker. Now here also, the constitution does not mention that the speaker must be from the ruling party. See, in fact, when you look back, there were instances where members who were not belonging to the ruling party were also elected to the office of the speaker. So this is all about the election of a speaker. Now moving on to the next part, which is the tenure of the Lok Sabha speaker. See, the speaker's term is similar with the term of the Lok Sabha, that is the 5-year term. And additionally, when the Lok Sabha is dissolved, the speaker remains in his office till the first meeting of the new assembly and until the new speaker is elected. Okay, so this is basically the tenure enjoyed by the speaker. Now coming to the removal. See, as I said earlier, the speaker's term is similar with the term of the Lok Sabha, which is 5 years. But you should know that this term of 5 years is not absolute. In the sense, the constitution has given the lower house, that is the Lok Sabha, the authority to remove the speaker if needed. So on that line, the house has got the rights to remove the speaker through a resolution which is passed by an effective majority, that is more than 50% of the total strength of the house present and voting. And this is done as per articles 94 and 96 of the Indian constitution. Now here you should note the difference. That is, for the election of speaker, simple majority is required, whereas for the removal of a speaker, effective majority is required. And apart from this, the speaker can also be removed on getting disqualified from being a Lok Sabha member under sections 7 and 8 of the Representation of the People's Act of 1951. See, we already saw that the Constitution just states that the speaker must be a member of the House. So that means if the speaker disqualifies to be the member of the House, then it means that he also disqualifies to be the speaker of Lok Sabha. So have this in mind as well. Now, additionally, apart from all these criteria, the speaker can also tender his or her resignation to the deputy speaker. Now, here also note that the president administers the oath of affirmation of the speaker, but then the speaker tenders his resignation to the deputy speaker. So here you should note the difference. So in the absence of the speaker, generally the deputy speaker discharges a function. So any member from the panel of chairman presides over the house in the absence of both the speaker, and during cases where both the speaker and the deputy speaker are absent, then a member from the panel of chairman presides over the house. Now here note that the word absence means when a speaker and deputy speaker is in vacation or leave. See, when the offices of both the speaker and the deputy speaker fall vacant, now here you should know the word vacant, the duties of the house of the speaker are performed by such member of the Lok Sabha as the president may appoint for this purpose. See, generally in the prelims, UPSC tend to twist the fact and ask the question. So whenever you learn such topics like president, prime minister, governor or speaker, you just make sure to note the important points like absence, vacant, simple majority, effective majority. So are the major points of difference between each post. So with this, let us wind up this discussion. So in this discussion, we revised various aspects of the office of the speaker, like his position in the order of precedence, his election, his tenure, and also his removal procedure. So now with these learned points, let's move on to the next news discussion. Now let us take up this news article regarding the Iron Dome system. So the news here is that recently the United States has decided to provide $1 billion to resupply the Israel's Iron Dome missile defense system. So in this light, we are going to see some important facts about the mentioned Israeli Iron Dome system. See, this Iron Dome system is a short-range ground-to-air air defense system which is manufactured by the Rafale Advanced Defense Systems. So the development of this Iron Dome system can be traced back to the year 2006 when the Israeli-Lebanon war happened, because during which Hezbollah fired thousands of rockets into Israel. So following that event, Israel, they announced to come up with a new air defense system that would be designed in a way to protect its cities and people, and that led to the emergence of the Israeli Iron Dome defense system. See, this Iron Dome system is capable of being used in all weather conditions, that too both during day as well as during night. And not just that, it is capable of engaging itself with multiple targets simultaneously. That is, at the same time, it is capable of engaging with many targets. See, this is a multi-mission system, and this multi-mission system is capable of intercepting rockets, artillery and mortars. And not just that, it is also capable of intercepting aircraft, helicopters and unmanned aerial vehicles. And it possesses this capability over short ranges of up to 70 kilometers. And know that it can be deployed both over land as well as over sea. Now, when talking about its working, see, the Iron Dome consists of three main systems, and these three main systems are the detection and the tracking radar, the battle management and weapon control system, and then a missile firing unit of three vertical launchers with 20 interceptor missile each. So what happens is these three systems, they work together and they together provide a shield over the area where it is deployed by handling multiple threads in that particular area. So in the process, they use a proximity fuse to detonate the target warhead in the air. So you can have a look at this picture for a better understanding of its functioning. So one unique feature of this Iron Dome system is its ability to identify the anticipated impact point of the threatening rocket. And not just that, it also has a capability to decide on the engaging action by calculating whether the threatening rocket will fall in a built-up area or not. And this helps in preventing the unnecessary interception of rockets and also the damage that is caused by it in open areas. But however, everything comes at a cost. That is, the system has got its own limitations as well. Say for example, and one major limitation of this Iron Dome is the saturation point. That is, this system has got saturation point, meaning it is capable of engaging only up to a certain number of targets at a same time. And if at all additional rockets are fired in a crowd, then at such instances it cannot defend, and this will eventually lead to damage. So this is one major shortcoming, and also an important shortcoming that is associated with Iron Dome. So with this, we have come to the end of this news article. Now look at this news article. This article reports about the latest excavations that is being made at the Maligai Medu, which is situated near Gangai Konda Cholapuram, which is situated in the Arialur district. So a copper coin and an ivory object, glass beads and bangles were some of the recent findings that were made in this place. And not just that, even substantial portions of brick structures have been unearthed by archaeologists here. And these structures are believed to be the remains of a Chola palace. So this is the basic crux of this article here. Now in this context, let us very briefly see about the said Gangai Konda Cholapuram, which is mentioned in today's news. See, whenever we read about Cholas, the first thing that comes to our mind about them is that the Cholas are one of the longest ruling dynasties in the southern regions of India. So basically, their rule began in the 9th century after they defeated the Pallavas, and since then they were ruling until the 13th century. And it was only during the medieval period of Indian history this Chola dynasty witnessed absolute power and development. And one major reason for this was that it was during this period only the prominent rulers of the Chola dynasty expanded their kingdom into the Tamil region. So one such powerful and also a prominent ruler of the Chola dynasty is the Rajendra Chola, who is mentioned in today's discussion. Know that Rajendra Chola is the son of the mighty Rajaraja Chola, and this person, Rajaraja Chola, only built the famous Brihadeshwara temple. So this person, that is the Rajendra Chola, he was well known for his vast empire and also for having a strong military and naval force. He was such an efficient ruler that his rule is considered to be the golden age of Cholas. Remember, he became the first Chola king to venture into the banks of Ganga. And as we know, the rulers back then, they had a practice of creating inscriptions or to build structures to commemorate their victory. And this was followed by the Rajendra Chola as well, because after his conquest of the Gangetic Plains, he built a great city, and it is this city which was named as Gangai Konda Cholapuram. And adding to that, he also built a Shiva temple called the Gangai Konda Cholishwarar and the lake Chola Gangam in order to commemorate his victory in the Gangetic Plains. So after the construction, the king shifted his capital from Tanjavur to this newly built town, and since then this city served as the capital for the Chola Empire till the end of the Chola family rule. So that is all about the Gangai Konda Cholapuram. And according to today's news, materials like a Chola period copper coin, an ivory object, glass beads, bangles, hopscotch markers, spouted knobs, terracotta pieces, and even ceramics such as red ware, black ware, decorated ware, and Chinese ware were the materials were found from the excavations that was made in this age-old city, that is the city of Gangaikonda Cholapuram. And know that it is widely believed that the palaces of Chola kings had existed there about 1000 years ago, and they were believed to have been destroyed during the Pandya invasions or later. And the present structural evidence that is available also supports that view. So with that, let's wind this discussion and move on to the next news article. Now look at this news article. So this article basically reports about a decision that was made by the Central Bank of China. So the news here is that China's Central Bank has declared all the financial transactions that are involving cryptocurrencies to be illegal. So this is the news here. Now based on this context, let us have a very basic understanding about cryptocurrencies. See, in simple words, a cryptocurrency is a digital or a virtual currency, and generally these cryptocurrencies can be brought using credit card or through mining, which is a process of earning them without spending money. That is, in this process of mining, the cryptocurrencies are gained by solving cryptographic equations through the use of computers. See, have in mind, many cryptocurrencies are decentralized networks which are based on blockchain technology. And for those who don't know, a blockchain is a specific type of database in which the data is stored in blocks that are chained together in chronological order. And this database is used in a decentralized way, that is without any central authority, so that no single person or a group has control, but instead all users collectively retain control over them. See, using cryptocurrencies, we can transfer funds directly between two parties without the need for a trusted third party, say like that of a bank or a credit card company. And have in mind, these transfers are secured by the use of public keys and private keys. And in addition to that, they are also secured using different forms of incentive systems. So for those who are not aware, the public key and private key are the major tools that are required to ensure the security of the crypto economy. See, the funds which are generally transferred using cryptocurrencies are completed with minimal processing fees. So thereby, it allows the users to avoid the steep fees that is charged by the banks and the financial institutions for wire transfers. So this is one major advantage that is associated with the use of cryptocurrencies. But then cryptocurrencies has also got a lot of problems or concerns associated with it, and one such problem with a cryptocurrency is the semi-anonymous nature of the cryptocurrency transaction. That is, in cryptocurrency transactions, the transactions and the accounts can be traced, but the owner accounts are usually not easily traceable. So this quality of the cryptocurrency may easily facilitate crimes like drug trafficking, prostitution, terrorism, money laundering, tax evasion, and also other illegal undermining activity which may benefit from moving money in untraceable ways. And apart from this, another major concern is the volatile nature of them. So to understand better, see, the market prices for cryptocurrencies are generally based on supply and demand. So the rate at which a cryptocurrency can be exchanged for another currency can fluctuate widely, mainly because the design of many cryptocurrencies ensures a high degree of scarcity. So this is also one of the concern or a shortcoming that is associated with cryptocurrency. So with this, we have come to the end of the article discussion. So now let us move on to the next part of our Indo News analysis, which is going to be the practice question discussion. So look at this question about River Mahanadi. Statement 1, its basin also extends over smaller portions of Jharkhand, Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, in addition to Chhattisgarh and Odisha. And statement 2, it is the second largest east flowing peninsula river. So we need to find the correct option here. See, when you take the first statement, it is correct because its basin extends over 5 states and it extends over major parts of Chhattisgarh and Odisha and comparatively smaller parts of Jharkhand, Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh. So that makes the first statement to be correct. Now coming to the second statement, see, this statement is incorrect because it is the Krishna River which is the second largest east flowing peninsula river, whereas Mahanadi river system is the third largest in the peninsula India and also the largest river of the Orisha state. And at the same time, in terms of water potential, then Mahanadi river ranks second to that of the Godavari river among the peninsular rivers. So this statement is incorrect, and since only the first statement is right here, the correct option will be option A, which is one only. Now look at this question. Consider the following statements regarding pro tem speaker. First statement is, the pro tem speaker is appointed by the prime minister. Statement 2, generally the senior most member of the house is chosen as pro tem speaker. Statement 3, he administers the oath of office the newly elected members of the parliament. And the fourth statement, he oversees the election of the new speaker. See, actually, after a general election and the formation of a new government, a list of senior Lok Sabha members, which is prepared by legislative section, is submitted to the Minister of Parliamentary Affairs, who in turn will select a pro tem speaker. So the appointment has to be approved by the president. So the pro tem speaker is appointed by the president in case of Lok Sabha and by the governor in case of a legislative assembly. So that makes the first statement incorrect. But apart from this, all the second, third and fourth statements are correct with respect to the pro tem speaker. So the right answer here would be option C, that is 2, 3 and 4 only. Now moving on to the next question. Consider the following statements regarding the production linked incentive scheme for promoting domestic manufacturing of medical devices. Statement 1, the scheme will be implemented by the project management agency nominated by the Department of Pharmaceutical. And statement 2, under the scheme, 5% incentive will be provided on incremental sales over base year, that is financial year 2019-20, of medical devices manufactured in India. So here again, we should find the correct statement. See, the production linked incentive scheme for promoting the domestic manufacturing of medical devices is also a scheme that was launched by the Department of Pharmaceutical. So some important points about the scheme is that it has an incentive of 5% on incremental sales over base year, that is financial year 2019-20, of the goods manufactured in India. And secondly, coming to the targeted segment under the scheme, a broad range of product segments ranging from capital equipments, implants and consumables are the targeted segment of the scheme. And apart from this, the production linked incentives of up to 3,420 crore will be awarded in the scheme's tenure, and the tenure of the scheme is from the financial year 2020-21 to the financial year 2027-2028. So with this understanding, we can find that both the statements which is given here are correct. So that makes option C, that is both 1 and 2, to be correct here. And a reminder here, please note the difference between the two schemes, that is the production linked incentive scheme which we discussed now, with the scheme that we discussed today regarding the medical devices manufacturing sector. So now let's move on to the next question. Now look at this question. Iron Dome is often mentioned in the news. What is it about? Statement A, climate engineering system. Statement B, cyber protection system. Statement C, air defense system. And statement D, environmental management system. So based on our discussion, we can easily infer that option C, that is the air defense system, is the right answer here. So with this, we have come to the end of today's Hindu news analysis. So if you've liked the video, then don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC civil services preparation.